Amid these upheavals, a new paradox took shape in the form of a dualistic challenge to international order, with Iran's revolution, an Islamist movement dedicated to overthrowing the Westphalian system, gained control over a modern state and asserted its Westphalian rights and privileges, taking up its seat at the United Nations, conducting its trade and operating its diplomatic apparatus. Iran's clerical regime thus placed itself at the intersection of two world orders, arrogating the formal protections of the Westphalian system, even while repeatedly proclaiming that it did not believe in it, would not be bound by it, and intended ultimately to replace it. This duality has been ingrained in Iran's governing doctrine. Iran styles itself as the Islamic Republic, implying an entity whose authority transcends territorial demarcations, and the Ayatollah heading the Iranian power structure, first Khomeini, then his successor Ali Khamenei, is conceived of not simply as an Iranian political figure, but as a global authority, the supreme leader of the Islamic Revolution, and the leader of the Islamic Ummah and oppressed people. The Islamic Republic announced itself on the world stage with a massive violation of a core principle of the Westphalian international system, diplomatic immunity, by storming the American embassy in Tehran and holding its staff hostage for 444 days, an act affirmed by the current Iranian government, which in 2014 appointed the hostage taker's translator to serve as its ambassador at the United Nations. In a similar spirit, in 1989, Ayatollah Khomeini claimed global juridical authority in issuing a fatwa, religious proscription, pronouncing a death sentence on Salman Rushdie, a British citizen of Indian Muslim descent, for his publication of a book in Britain and the United States deemed offensive to Muslims. Even while simultaneously conducting normal diplomatic relations with the countries whose territory these groups have in part arrogated, Iran, in its Islamist aspect, has supported organizations such as Hezbollah in Lebanon and the Mahdi Army in Iraq, non-state militias challenging established authorities and employing terror attacks as part of their strategy. Tehran's imperative of Islamic revolution has been interpreted to permit cooperation across the Sunni-Shia divide to advance broader anti-Western interests, including Iran's arming of the Sunni jihadist group Hamas against Israel and, according to some reports, the Taliban in Afghanistan. The report of the 9/11 Commission and investigations of the 2013 terrorist plot in Canada suggested that Al-Qaeda operatives had found scope to operate from Iran as well. On the subject of the need to overthrow the existing world order, Islamists on both sides, Sunni and Shia, have been in general agreement. However intense the Sunni-Shia doctrinal divide erupting across the Middle East in the early 21st century, Sayyid Qutb's views were essentially identical to those put forward by Iran's political ayatollahs. Qutb's premise that Islam would reorder and eventually dominate the world struck a chord with the men who recast Iran into the fount of religious revolution. Qutb's works circulate widely in Iran, some personally translated by Ayatollah Ali Khamenei. As Khamenei wrote in his 1967 introduction to Qutb's work, The Future of This Religion, this lofty and great author has tried in the course of the chapters of this book to first introduce the essence of the faith as it is, and then, after showing that it is a program of living, to confirm with his eloquent words and his particular world outlook that ultimately world government shall be in the hands of our school and the future belongs to Islam. For Iran, representing the minority Shia branch of this endeavor, victory could be envisioned through the sublimation of doctrinal differences for shared aims. Toward this end, the Iranian constitution proclaims the goal of the unification of all Muslims as a national obligation. In accordance with the sacred verse of the Quran, this, your community, is a single community, and I am your Lord, so worship me. All Muslims form a single nation, and the government of the Islamic Republic of Iran has the duty of formulating its general policies with a view to cultivating the friendship and unity of all Muslim peoples, and it must constantly strive to bring about the political, economic, and cultural unity of the Islamic world. The emphasis would be not on theological disputes, but on ideological conquest. As Khomeini elaborated, we must strive to export our revolution throughout the world and must abandon all idea of not doing so, for not only does Islam refuse to recognize any difference between Muslim countries, it is the champion of all oppressed people. This would require an epic struggle against America, the global plunderer, and the communist materialist societies of Russia and Asia, as well as Zionism and Israel.